And we are live. It's Dr. J here in the house with Dr. Christine Schaffner. Really excited to interview Dr. Christine today. You can find more about Dr. Christine at drchristineschaffner.com. We'll put the link below for y'all. Dr. Christine, how are you doing this morning? Nice to meet you.
Oh, it's so nice to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
Absolutely. So I know you have a summit coming out called the Body Electric 2.0 Summit, where you talk about all things from energy medicine to sound medicine to EMFs to all kinds of sound vibration, all kinds of cool little things. We're going to dive into a couple of these aspects today. If anyone's really interested in this content out of the gates, we'll put the Body Electric 2.0 Summit link down below so you guys can get more access to that awesome information. Dr. Christine, how are we doing?
We're good. We're good. And I just appreciate the opportunity to share this topic. I'm so passionate about this field of medicine. And you and I both treat really chronically ill, complex patients. And I love our functional medicine. I love our naturopathic medicine. I love the realm of what we call bioregulatory medicine. But I think we're still in this pioneering opportunity to really integrate more therapies and more approaches that utilize the understanding of our biophysical nature, and that we have this body electric. And this is the title of, the late Dr. Becker's work. And he was ahead of his time, but knowing that, again, we're beyond our biochemistry. So we obviously have hormones and cytokines and all the ways that our body communicates and regulates, but we also have this electromagnetic nature. And I always start with the heart because I think people can understand that. And we know that our heart has the strongest electromagnetic field in our body. And I had Dr. Roland McCready from HeartMath. They're doing amazing research on really how the heart informs the brain. And the heart is really the great orchestrator in this electromagnetic nature in our body. And even if you think about beyond the field in our heart, we actually have sensory neurites, about 40,000 in our heart. And we have direct lines of communication from our heart to our brain. And so getting our heart in the state of what we would call coherence and sounds complicated, but it's really simple in how we can practice things like gratitude and, the things that make us feel good actually have this really important biological effect to regulate our body. And so we have our electromagnetic nature of our heart. We know we have brain waves that are measured with EEG. So we know that medical science, conventional medicine understands the applications and the implications of biophysics to either diagnose and to also understand where we might need treatment. So also beyond that, we have ultrasound, right? Using sound waves, our eyes, using magnetic resonance. And so, when we think about that too, so we have that understanding. And then I have Dr. Beverly Rubik, who's a biophysicist from UC Berkeley. I've just loved her work over the years. And she coined the term biofield, and she put that in PubMed in 1996, 1994. So it was a medical term that was searchable and that people could really research this understanding that we have this a field of information and energy that surrounds our body that is comprised of low light emissions, and it's measurable. I'm hoping, in my lifetime, we have more and more things that we can use in the office to measure this field of energy. And it's not just this random field of energy that's kind of this offshoot of all of the biophysical things that are happening in the body, but it's actually a field of information that also informs our body. So in order to really heal a chronic illness and to heal our biochemistry, we have to look at this field of information and energy around us and use tools and therapies that can help heal where there could be incoherence or dissonance or stagnation in our energy that can translate into physical symptoms.
So let's try to connect it to patients so they can get an application of how it actually improves their health. I find if we have all this information, but we can't really apply it, then it's not as useful. So out of the gates, you kind of talked about some of the coherence stuff and some of the heart. I think you said, 70% of the heart neurons that are actually, they're actually like brain neurons or neurological tissue, not just heart muscle. Is that correct?
Yeah. There's 40,000 sensory neurites in the heart. So meaning that our heart has a brain, you know, and that information and information goes directly to key parts in our brain too, that help us not only have more coherent brain waves and more organized neurology, but also helps to connect to what we call the limbic part of our brain. That is a lot of where our stored trauma can happen, our kind of automatic reactions can happen in life. So to make it really practical, and I love that, really simple practices of getting in a state of positive emotion can actually help to strengthen the rhythm of our heart, and that informs our brain. And so a gratitude practice, a lot of kind of self-help gurus, you know, are like recommending this, you know, gratitude journal, you know, the work of Joe Dispenza, and I love Tony Robbins, and, you know, all those wonderful people who really have these morning rituals often, or even evening rituals, or bookend your day on, you know, having this, this gratitude practice can be not just a feel good energy, but it can really make your body heal.
So in regards to the kind of the execution of that, for myself, it's breathing, right? And try to have some type of gratitude and focus on my breath, try to really activate a lot of the parasympathetic neurons by breathing through my nose versus breathing through my mouth, and then focusing on good breath and then all the gratitude. Is it that simple, or is there any more nuance to it so patients can execute it?
Yeah, you know, I think for this piece, it's really that simple. There are measurable tools and more wearable devices, or things that people are implementing more and more to look at what we call heart rate variability. And that is a direct window into our parasympathetic nervous system. And the more variability we have, the more that our body can switch into parasympathetic mode. And it's kind of a marker of longevity and health. And so that's another tool that we can track. HeartMath, you can actually buy devices through HeartMath that track heart rate variability, and it can be biofeedback to see when you're in these states, what it does to your heart rate variability. There's also the Oura Ring. There's also like Elite HRV.
Do you have a favorite one for you that you use with patients or yourself?
Yeah, you know, I've been using Elite HRV, and then there's also the Oura Ring. I like the Oura Ring because you can turn off the Bluetooth on that. And so I have a lot of sensitive patients to EMF, so they get a little wary of trackable devices, which I totally understand. And then in the office, I have a really unique therapy called Sound of Soul that actually measures your heart rate variability and then converts your heart rate variability to music, and then it plays it back to you. And this is, this ultimate biofeedback of turning your own heart rhythm into music to actually create more coherence in your body. And it translates into like a lot of not only feeling of peace and parasympathetic states, but also can be very healing for the emotional body. I have an Austrian researcher and the creator of this, Erasmus Gaut-Berghausen, who's on the summit as well. And he studied with Dr. Emoto, who is the water guy, right? Who studied
water guy,
who could put intention with water and how that changed the crystalline structure of the water. And, you know, we are mostly water, right? And so I have a lot of speakers who talk about all these nuances with water too. So we know about exclusion zone water, structured water, and deuterium depletion and hydrogen water. But, you know, knowing that we're water, you know, and knowing that we can change the water in our body by, you know, having, you know, positive sounds. And there's all, I mean, I can go down the list of, you know, this other direction, but that's another tool I use in the office to look at heart rate variability and how the music of your heart can improve your heart rate variability.
Okay. And so the best kind of at-home things that people can get their hands on out of the gates, I know the M-Wave is a wonderful device that you can do. Obviously, Oura Ring is excellent as well. Any other kind of wearable or at-home things that you do yourself personally, or that you recommend for patients so they can look at this, kind of dial it in and optimize their physiology?
As far as heart rate variability and heart coherence, I think we have that covered. You know, other tools that I use at home are in the realm of photobiomodulation and sound medicine that we go in depth on Body Electric 2.0, and I'm happy to share more about that as well.
Yeah, let's talk about that. So what's photobiomodulation? I'm guessing something to do with light.
So, you know, this is, I think, such a fascinating part of medicine, and we are wired to respond to light, right? So we have things in our body called chromophores, and chromophores are, they respond to different wavelengths of light, and light is part of the visible part of the electromagnetic spectrum. And so, you know, it ranges from UV light to infrared light and everything in between. And each of those sections of light or colors of light are, they correspond to different wavelengths of light, and then different wavelengths of light have different activities in the body, right? So the things that we're thinking about when we think about photobiomodulation is, okay, what's the wavelength of light? What does that translate of what we call depth of penetration in our tissues? Mm-hmm. Is it going to scratch the surface, or is it going to go deeper into the body where we can affect even more change? And then there's a whole other realm, not only called photobiomodulation, but it's called photodynamic therapy, which we talk about also in the summit. And photodynamic therapy is pairing something called photosensitizers, so natural substances and also synthetic, that actually make us more able to receive treatment from light. For example, things like riboflavin or methylene blue or, you know, green tea or poly-MVA or artesanine, or all the things. Those substances actually get taken up to, this is where I just continue to like marvel at nature. So inflamed cells and cancer cells more naturally take up those photosensitizers and then make them more vulnerable to different wavelengths of light. And so for instance, if we're trying to, you know, affect the mitochondria, we might use, you know, red light paired with methylene blue or so forth. So we can use that combination. And that's an in-office tool at this point. We use IV laser, we use topical laser, but at home you can use more photobiomodulation tools. And so the things at home that I think are really helpful are in the spectrum of red and infrared. I have on my desk here a sauna space photon that I love, which is near infrared. I put it on all the time when I'm, you know, working, and that helps to penetrate a little bit more deeply into my cells. And it helps to not only have a heating action, which improves circulation, blood flow, detoxification, but it also helps to tell part of our mitochondria to help to produce more energy. So I think that, you know, more and more tools, Dr. J, are more affordable, you know, and, you know, more accessible. I also have even like a little Juve traveler that I have on my desk. My daughter loves it, you know, but it's red and red light. And so that's cool. Exciting. Weber makes a laser helmet. So it has red and infrared. And I think that is,
you know, what company is that?
Weber Medical. They are an outfit out of Germany. Dr. Weber is this wonderful German physician who really pioneered the use of photodynamic therapy, especially with oncology. But the Weber laser helmet is infrared, so it actually penetrates through the skull into the brain. And so again, you compare that with photosensitizers or just do it alone, and that can help clear things like amyloid beta or things that affect and trigger neuroinflammation or improve the lymphatic system, you know, at night. And So there's a lot of exciting tools in the realm of photobiomodulation and photodynamic therapy. But the premise of that is that we're wired to receive light. And then also there's a whole, we have people who are talking about color puncture on the summit. Dr. Peter Mandel is a German naturopath who, you know, knows the work of Fritz Albert Popp with the biophoton theory, that our cells, again, not only communicate with biochemistry, but with biophotons. So low level light emissions. And we know when healthy cells emit coherent, organized light, and disease cells do not. And so they're incoherent, low levels of light. So you can add biophotons to the body to help heal the cells. And color puncture, we have Dr. Peter Mandel and Rosemary Bourne talking about it. And it's a wonderful adjunct therapy to the work that we do.
Okay, so the things that people can do at home out of the gates is get some kind of a red light device. I have a Juve. Juve's nice. We'll put a link down below for the Juve. I've seen some of the sauna space light bulbs. Those are nice too, out of the gates, pretty inexpensive. Anything else that, any other tech devices that people can get access to that they can apply in their daily life?
Yeah, you know, I think not only like thinking about photobiomodulation, photodynamic therapy, but I think also another key point, Dr. J, is circadian lighting. So I think, you know, our our brain really responds to light and the cycle of light throughout the day. So the natural rhythms of light, and we're around a lot of what we will call junk lighting. We have a lot of inappropriate wavelengths of light at different times that affect our circadian rhythms. So, you know, you want kind of blue light in the morning, and you want more red and amber lights during night to tell your pineal gland that it's nighttime, to produce healthy amounts of melatonin that really help to not only help restore your sleep, but to heal your brain. I've been a fan of Dave Asprey's True Dark Circadian light. I have it here. I can turn it red at night when I'm working, when I'm too late, when I should be in bed, but I turn it, you know, to, you know, red. Again, there's all sorts of screensavers to help. And then of course, blue blocking glasses.
Right. Okay, cool. So the blue blocking glasses I like. And then what's that True Dark technology? Is that just the light that goes on, that goes brighter, that more red at night, so less to inhibit melatonin?
Yeah, you can basically change the wavelength of light throughout the day. So you can use the brighter blue tones during the day and kind of the turn it into like a redder amber at night. It's really nice.
Something to kind of bump cortisol during the day with the blue, but then also maybe decrease cortisol and more kind of support melatonin production at night with more of the red and amber light.
Yeah. And, you know, we need blue in the morning to break down our melatonin. So we're not sleeping. Yeah. So, you know, and then, you know, again, if we're overexposed to blue light at bedtime, we're not getting that signal in our body's not, you know, producing melatonin in its optimal levels.
Yeah, that makes sense. So what about wireless technology? What about EMF? What about Wi-Fi? What are things that we can do? Because sometimes, you know, we have to engage in this to work and to do all the things we got to do. One, is it safe? Two, what are things that we can do to mitigate any stress it may be causing on our body?
Yeah, you know, it's a great question. And I think we're learning more and more each year. You know, obviously, technology makes our life very connected. There's so many, you know, benefits of it, but it does have, you know, effects on the body, and it's cumulative over time, right? Electromagnetic radiation has a cumulative over time effect. And I think why it's such a problem right now is because there's no breaks during our day, you know, that we are not exposed to all sorts of either microwave or RF or, you know, dirty electricity or magnetic fields. And so I have Nicholas Pineau and Lloyd Burrell on the side, you know, talking about EMF. And, you know, the thing that I like patients to focus on, because it can be so overwhelming. And when you have, again, I see chronically ill people who often have a neurological illness. And, you know, when you're trying to heal from a neurological illness, you really, this is really important, because this can be very disruptive for your health. It can affect peroxynitrite. It can affect melatonin production, glutathione. It can put you in the cell danger response. So we know this. And so how do we break the time, you know, that we're exposed? And I think focusing on your sleeping location is really important. This is a time when your body needs to heal, repair. It's a time that the lymphatic system works. And so, you know, if you can do kind of layered things, right? So turn off your Wi-Fi at night. If you're really sick, I would encourage you not to have Wi-Fi in your home. If you, you know, again, don't bring any devices in your room, try to, you know, not bring your phone in your room or your iPad. And then again, looking at dirty electricity, in the wiring of the wall. So that has to do with household wiring. You can measure that with something called a Stetzer filter. There's also green wave filters that come with little devices that you can plug into your outlets and see, you know, is there a disharmonic electrical field being emitted from the wall and, you know, disturbing our body. And then the solution, it's an expense, but it's simple. You just put a filter that helps to create more of a harmonious electrical current from the wall. So thinking about dirty electricity, turning off the Wi-Fi. You know, again, depending on how sick people are and where they live, I mean, if a cell phone tower or 5G tower is like right across the you know, street from you, you might have to up, you know, the protection. So again, just focusing on the bedroom first. So you can work with a building biologist. I love the work of Brian Hoyer with Shielded Healing. People like that who can come and measure and really give you specific guidance for your home and what to spend money on. on. So is that ceiling pain? Is that, you know, films over your windows? Is that a sleep canopy? Is that moving your bedroom into another place of your house? Because, you know, distance is your friend. So a lot of times, if we can manipulate those variables, people can find, you know, how they can at least optimize their sleeping location.
What about like EMF harmonizing devices? Obviously, I have, I think I have some of the Green Wave electricity filters, right? I think that's what you were recommending earlier. What about some of the EMF harmonizing devices you'll see put on phones or like little pendants or maybe even a grounding mat? Are those worthwhile? Do they have a beneficial effect?
It's a great question. And, you know, the Green Wave or dirty electricity that are, you know, work, and then there are these harmonizers, right? I have Mindy Beck, Dr. Mindy Beck on the, you know, summit, and she has a company called U-Matrix where she works with a French researcher. And, you know, I've been always really skeptical of harmonizers because I think, okay, how, you know, how does that work with, you know, my, you know, limited understanding of biophysics, right? My mind is opening that there's a place for harmonizing technology. You know, when we think of just principles of physics, we can, you know, change energy and information to either make it a healing frequency or a harmful frequency. And what U-Matrix does is it's these little, I have one on my phone here, you can put them in your shoes. They have grounding discs. The grounding discs are quite cool in that you put them in the bottom of your feet. And when you walk on them, they're these crystalline kind of discs that when you walk on them, they stimulate what we call a piezoelectric effect in your, in your body. And it structures the water in your body that I think makes you more resilient to the oncoming stress. So I think about harmonizers, if there's a way that the harmonizing technology can increase your resilience to the, you know, constant assault, you know, of this information day in and day out. I think this is where we have to go. And I'm excited that there are more people looking at this and studying this because, you know, unfortunately we're just going to be, it's going to get worse before it gets better, before we can change technologies.
And how are you quantifying a lot of the benefits of these devices? Like, do you have a good EMF reader? I know there's one out there called Safe and Sound that's pretty good, or there's a tri-field meter that's pretty good too, where you can, you know, you can try some of these different blocker technologies and measure it. How are you quantifying it outside of just how you feel?
Yeah, you know, it's a good question. So, you know, there are, of course, data points, you know, with patient care. And then, you know, as far as looking at shielding technologies, you know, we think about looking at, you know, whether they're effective by, like you said, the Safe and Sound meter. The Coronet meter is kind of a, like a red, yellow, green kind of system that can be very helpful. Again, you know, knowing what you're measuring. So if you're measuring RF versus magnetic field, so tri-field meter. So those are, you know, great tools. I also just think that, you know, working with a building biologist is going to be the most helpful because they look can also measure what we call body voltage. So looking at how these mitigation tools actually change the effect on your physical body, right? So they can, you know, look at the change in body voltage to see how these things change actually the effect on your body. There's an Austrian group, GeoVital. They train people to look at this, and that's who Brian Hoyer studied with, and they have a lot of great information there.
Okay, cool. Excellent. Anything else you want to let patients know or the everyday person know about this kind of technology? I know a big question I get all the time is near infrared, far infrared, or both. What's your take on the two, and how are they different, you know, in regards to wavelength and such?
Yeah. So we have the infrared spectrum, right? And so there's near, middle, and far. So it depends on, you know, where you are in that category. I think all of them have, you know, a benefit. The far is going to be a little bit more, you know, penetrating. But I think that, you know, having a range, if you can kind of have a mix of all of those wavelengths, that's going to be the best. But again, I think that's, you know, I think we kind of maybe hyper focus on that a little too much. I think that whole spectrum of wavelength is healing for the body, and just finding a tool that's accessible and affordable for you and that you feel something from, I think is really important. And I didn't answer one of your questions, Dr. J, about grounding. Grounding mats have been around, and some are better than others. I've seen people feel really good from them, and I've seen people get worse. And when you have a grounding mat, you want to make sure that it's grounded. So you want to make make sure if you have to plug it in that that outlet is actually grounded. Yeah, so you can measure that, like Home Depot, just find something to look at that. So that's really important. Samina beds are, they're friends of mine, and they have a really nice grounding pad. It's more expensive, but it works very well if people need that kind of support. And then again, you don't need a fancy grounding pad. You can just go out in nature and put your feet in the ground, and that works. And I think grounding is just another practice, like gratitude, you know, that that really can help our physical bodies in so many ways, decrease inflammation, help with blood flow and circulation and so forth.
Got it. And so we have the short wave, that's more like the regular infrared red light, right? And then the longer wave, that's what you may get like at an infrared sauna.
Yeah, it depends. Like infrared sauna can be, it can be near middle or far, kind of the range.
You know, combination. Got it.
Yeah.
And so the short is good for what? And the long is good for what?
It's just depth of penetration. So the longer length, the more depth that will penetrate into your fat cells, right?
Okay, so got it. So short, maybe like topical skin or inflammation on the surface.
They still penetrate. I mean, I don't know off the top of my head the centimeters that they penetrate, but you still get it. That's the category of wavelength of light that gets the farthest in the body. And then it's just kind of semantics with the near, middle, and far. But it's going to, all of those are going to penetrate more than red light.
Got it. And I think that's what, like 700 nanometers and up to 2,000 or 3,000. Is that kind of where it's at?
Yeah. Red is 660 nanometers and near infrared is around 880. So I think, the cutoff is like 700 to 1200. It's
awesome.
Easily
doable. Awesome. Well, we're gonna put the links down below for your summit, and we're gonna do it justinhealth.com/bodyelectric. We'll put the link down below for everyone that's listening. They just want to click, you're good to go there. Any other real world kind of applicable information that people listening and they want to start taking control of their health, how do they use some of these cool techniques? Is there any other aspects that we haven't talked about yet you want to share?
Yeah, you know, there's one other aspect that I'm really excited about is that's the field of sound medicine. So, you know, we know ultrasound uses sound waves to diagnose and also treat our bodies therapeutically. And, you know, I had a woman who's a neurologist, Dr. Chaudhry, who wrote a book called Sound Medicine, if you want to dive deeper. And she's a neurologist who also studies ancient Indian texts that mapped out the body, that we all have, every body part has a resonant sound that basically can bring it back into balance. And so, you know, we can use sound medicine through mantras, chanting. Eileen McCusick talks about biofield tuning, so using tuning forks. I talked about Sound of Soul. But, you know, finding Nikki Gratrix is on the summit, and she uses a lot of meditations and sound therapies to also, you know, just to also help the body emotionally as well. And so I think, you know, sound medicine, I love sound baths. You know, there's a lot of things now through Zoom that you can do in the comfort of your own home, but we're wired to receive light and sound. And I think that can be finding the tools and therapies that are accessible to you in those categories can really support your healing on a lot of levels.
That's excellent, Dr. Christine. Really appreciate it. Well, we're going to put the links down below for the summit at justinhealth.com/bodyelectric. And then your site is drchristineschaffner.com. We'll put the spelling and the link down below for anyone listening. Any other coordinates you want to share the listeners with? You have a podcast or YouTube channel, anything else you want to share?
Yeah, thank you. I have a podcast that you can find on that website, The Spectrum of Health. Dr. Shea has been on it. And I also, my clinic is called Eminence Health, where we have a team of doctors who treat complex chronic illness with all of these modalities and more.
And you're primarily in the Seattle area?
Yeah, so I'm in Seattle. I'm a naturopathic doctor, so I can see new patients in a number of states. I've acquired a number of licenses over the pandemic, so I can treat more people virtually who are new, and I have a presence in Seattle and California.
Awesome, Dr. Christine. Well, really appreciate you sharing these excellent information. Again, for more information, y'all, click down below, get access to that summit where you're going to get 20 or 30 other really good expert speakers on all these different topics, and you can dive in. Dr. Christine, thank you so much.